trying to save our building. This is the musicians' building, and we're trying to save it. To make a long story short, the building was bought and paid for by the Black Union, the Local 208. And now today, after a merger, the union is trying to sell. The white union, the Local 10, and the Black Union merged in 1966, and they're trying to sell the building today. We, the tenants of this building, we want to preserve and save our building. It's got a lot of history behind it, okay, and we want to save it. So
my little boy told one man one day, he said, my dad is a jazz man, he plays jazz. And I said, no, he plays jazz. He also plays long hair music. You know, as a whole, they said Black musician only play the blues, which was not true. We had some to play concert music, jazz music, symphony music. I played with the Chicago, with South Shore Symphony.
I just can't imagine having to give up living in such an apartment as this. I've enjoyed it immensely, and I can't foresee not having such a place for artists and musicians to live. And I think that it's unfortunate that we are going to lose this building if this is the case.
Standing by. I started playing bass when I was 24 years old. That's quite an old age to start. But I had been playing ukulele and guitars, and I remember I got my first guitar for a bicycle wheel. Kid traded me a bicycle wheel for a little tenor uke. And I was too poor to buy strings, so I got some telephone wire and took the strands out of that and made strings for the ukulele. And that's what I played with. And I got pretty good at it. I mean, you know, we had these little groups in the neighborhood, so as I grew older, then all these musicians grew up. One of the great musicians, Wilbur Ware, he was a bass player. He was my idol. I idolized him. And that's why I'm playing bass now, for one reason, because I like the sound that he got out of the bass, and I strive to get the same sound that he got. And the heart of the instrument is in how you play it. I mean, you can play it thump, or you can play it with a boom, or you can play it with an oval egg-shaped sound, which I like, and which usually gives the rhythm a chance to modulate in within the rhythm. It's according to the sound that you play. And the sound that you play comes out of your hands. A lot of people think the sound of the instrument is in the instrument. That's part of the sound, but the other half of the sound is how you press the strings down, how hard you press the strings or how light you press the strings. And that gives you the soul of the person that's playing the instrument. I have a built-in inner beat, which is not rare, but either you got it or you don't have it. And I have it. I can take my bass and stand up, and I should be able to swing you just playing my bass. Do you understand what I mean? I should be able to take my bass in my hand and begin to play, and you feel the rhythm without big drums, piano, or anything. And that is what I strive to do.
Back before the merger, I served as president of the Musicians Credit Union 208. We had in the Musicians Local at that time approximately 1,500 members. And during the merger, we merged in with Local 10, the building at 53rd and Drexel. Our bank account and the Musicians Credit Union at that time, Local 10 did not have a credit union. So the merging of Local 208 with 10, which became 10-208, brought to them the building, the bank account, and the credit union. We had the understanding that this building would remain a property of the Musicians Union. We would hope that it will remain a property of the Musicians Union. It benefited a lot of the families of the musicians. The rent was such that we could live comfortably. And today we feel very strongly that the building can be renovated, it could remain the property of the Musicians Union, and it could benefit so many of the families whose parents actually sacrificed as musicians to see that the building was purchased.
When you would go to be interviewed for an apartment, if you didn't have references on a 9-to-5 job or what we call a day job, that you were immediately refused access to an apartment. So at the Musicians Union, they realized that quite a few fellows were having difficulty finding a decent place to live. So they did a they decided that they would do something constructive for the musician besides just collecting dues and protecting jobs that you've found for yourself and make sure that you pay dues on it. So they decided to buy this building. And they initiated a rescreening process at the union to see if the fellows that wanted to come in or the families were responsible and had paid their bills and were not destructive, and then they would give them an opportunity to come and live under good conditions.
I remember one incident. I lived after we moved in, the lights went out in the bathroom. So my husband called out to the union hall and reported that the lights didn't come on, it was a short. And we had one janitor that said, I'm going downstairs in the basement and check the lights. And when I holler, you let me know if the lights come on. I kept waiting and waiting, he never called. I went down to look, he hadn't gone in the building. So I called the union hall and reported that incident. The next day, my lights were fixed.
And the president of the union fixed the lights. He put on his overalls and went out and fixed the lights. Mr. Harry Gray would come
and I would like to give him credit.
Do a lot of maintenance on the building when the journeymen weren't available.
I remember when I was a child here that if it was real nice, I felt a sense of warmth from not only my family, but from the other musicians that were in here. I didn't know at that time that I was rubbing elbows with the likes of John Young or Roselle Claxton, who had played not only with famous musicians here in this country, but across the oceans.
Yeah.
I took it for granted then, as some of us do now, that the sounds that I was hearing was those of great musicians. And I think of nothing in the morning of waking up hearing the birds singing and then hearing piano solos and singers singing and then seeing these people coming out later on with their tuxedos on or carrying out basses or carrying out trumpets. I didn't think of it then, but it was having a great impact on me.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't realize that I was living inside a treasure.
Mm-hmm.
As I look at it now, we still have the same caliber of people, but I think that there's something lost because due to the fact that at that time we had an autonomous management with the union president. If you were to call him, he would come in and fix up the apartments or paint. He would handle the complaints directly. I also remember that around Christmas time, you could think of nothing for the union members to bring turkeys and candies. At Easter, we got Easter baskets.
Mm-hmm.
There was a sense of family and oneness. These people were not only giants of the music world, they also were giant human beings.
Mm-hmm.
When I look at what's happening now with the current membership, and I won't use racial terms, but the board is mostly white, as opposed to it all being black then. But it was small then, and it's larger now. The Chicago's 10208 is one of the largest unions in the country. And I would think that a union of that size and amount of money and the contracts that they deal with should have this building be a showplace rather than a disgrace.
Mm-hmm.
And that's exactly what it is now.
The sound that came from this building is what attracted me when I was like 11 and 12 years old. I used to sit out here on the perch. At that time, the grass was green, okay? You didn't have dirt patches, you understand? And the sidewalk was almost like white, as if somebody had hosed them down every day, okay? I would hear musicians playing, and I would hear groups and individuals playing and stuff like that. See, I lived at 5404 Lake Park, and right on the corner of 5404 Lake Park, they had a club called Cozy Corner.
A
lot of musicians used to come to Cozy Corner, you understand? Musicians from this building, you understand? People like Billie Holiday, Lester Young, you know? And this is something in the books that have been written about these musicians, you understand, that people don't ever know. They didn't know that Charlie Parker would buy everybody in the neighborhood ice cream and Billie Holiday. She would give you $4 and $5 to watch her little pool, Chi-Chi, you know? And they didn't know that when we had sock hops over at Kosminski, you understand, that the musicians in this building used to give nickels and dimes to us to go to the Frolic Theater, which was on 55th Street, or the Piccadilly. Mm-hmm. You understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. We had an outlet, you understand, based on the musicians in this building and the way they felt about the kids in the neighborhood and stuff. So when I got into music, I wanted to be a part of this building because it's a part of my roots.
Musicians back in the 20s and 30s, and I believe it resulted in their effort. It used to be headquarters, so to speak. It's a shame to see that it's sort of getting integrated out of existence.
Every other country has a place for the artists to go. They honor their artists, and here, nothing.
The importance of it is the culture that it would add to our neighborhood that
right.
all of these musicians have traveled
That's
all over the world
right.
to bring to the younger people. That's
right.
one of the important things, I think.
It encouraged the young people, especially the ones
sure.
that are interested in the music. It's so much encouragement for them to watch or to come and be able to come and visit
and
watch the jam sessions of the musicians.
A lesson here or there to a young kid who maybe can't afford a lesson. He
yeah.
says, okay, kid, come on in. I'll give
right.
you a couple of turns on this, the piano, horn,
yeah.
or something like that.
And they won't have to be worried
That's
about
right.
them
Keep
taking
them
advantage
the
of
too.
Them because they can train them and teach them, and you don't have to be worried
That's
about
right.
it. The older guys are really...
And they are good neighbors.
Yeah.
They're
mm-hmm.
never any trouble to anybody because when they're practicing, they will stop practicing at a certain time so as not to disturb the neighbors.
Right.
They really do that.
Paper and we've discussed it, but I just want to make an official record of the meeting that you correct me if I'm wrong, the building has been sold, and what we're trying to do is avert
the
closing.
Yes.
Right.
Because if the closing goes through,
then that's it.
Okay, is everybody aware of the fact that the building was sold before they sent out the ballots?
It wasn't
okay.
sold, but it was, they had
it
taken
had
money. They had taken
offer.
Money.
Exactly.
They had taken
they had
money
to
finish
the
winner.
Is everybody aware of that fact?
Yep.
Yeah.
That's where you are. So it was stated by the president in the reader. And as I suggested at one of our prior meetings, I think at our last meeting, that could possibly something that the lawyer can tell us whether or not it's a ground
for
to use for filing an injunction.
Okay. Kay and I, we drew up a letter, and so I sent it registered mail last week, about Thursday, I think. And so we expect to be hearing from them real soon. I have not got the return receipt yet, but I anticipate them receiving it Monday or Tuesday. And so if I haven't gotten it by then, by Tuesday, I'll probably just go and visit Ward's office and ask for it.
Okay. Why don't you read it out? Why don't you read it out loud? So
okay, the letter states, "Dear Mr. Ward, after several requests to get a copy of the initial merger agreement that took place between the Local 10 and the Local 208 in 1966, we decided to call the national office. The national office informed us that we should have been able to get a copy from our local union. This letter is a formal request for a copy of the merger agreement that took place between the Local 10 and the Local 208. Thank you."
The last meeting, Paul Serrano had indicated that he was going to talk to Ms. Saunders and Ed McCants' wife. Well, they might be the same person, you know.
Ms. Sam, yeah.
Okay. And who was working directly with the president and the vice president, taking notes and things of that nature.
Right.
And Paul Serrano hasn't got back with any of us to indicate exactly what he got out of that. Well, what kind of information did he
get
back?
Well, he said he talked to her for a long time, and that, to her knowledge, she does not know who has the merger agreement or what exactly it was, you know, how it was stated. She didn't know. So that's why I was going to the National Union, because we should be able to get a copy of it. And they definitely have a copy.
Well, each time they promised us a meeting, or each time they promised us some kind of time or some kind of space, it was always a lie. So I would just act accordingly.
I don't know all the details, all the nuances, all the legal complications, but there's a moral question which is involved. And that is, there's a kind of an informal contract which the union had with its members. And that is, we're providing housing at a certain time and is at a certain cost, you know, to the members and so on. We've got to keep that commitment. And it seems to me that the membership of Local 208, you know, from the beginning, and the residents of this building, they have a legitimate struggle. And I think that anybody who believes in fair play, anybody who believes in what we really call genuine affirmative action and equality, ought to be with them in this fight. And I'm with them all the way.
To me, it's no other greater place for a musician to live than a musician building that really wants to get off into his music. Because all the other places I live, you could not rehearsal in the building. People's always complaining. So here, everybody got along like a family. And now, I wouldn't want to move any other place because I was living in the suburbs first. So I ended up here at the musician building. I've been here now about 8 or 9 years, and hey, I love it. And we do anything we can to save this building because it's very important to all the musicians that have lived here before I came here than the one that's living here now. And it's also been a great neighborhood and stuff, especially for my kids and stuff going to school, because mainly they grew up here, you know. So now, for us moving would be a whole different thing for me and for them, because it became a part of us. So actually, I'm at the Souterian in Gary, Indiana, and I like this place here because on the way from this job this evening, I come back to my home and doesn't have to feel any fear or anything like that, because it is my home now. And it's a safe place to live. I can bring my equipment in, I can leave it here, and I doesn't have to worry about anything because we have a nice tight security system here. And anyone that ever thinks that this place is not a safe place to live, you're very wrong, because we make sure that we get it together and do the right things and we stick together. And the longer we do this, we always have a safe place to live, especially for the musicians.
My funny Valentine, my sweet, sweet comic Valentine, you make me smile with my heart.
Ooh, I better try that one again.
You make me smile with my heart.
many inspirations. I feel like I was born with an inspiration. My mother played a key role in my development because she was a piano teacher. And we always had music in our house. She was a choir director, she was an evangelist, and I got a strong inspiration from the church. I mean the sanctified church. Outside of that, I've been inspired by friends, you know. Even in this building, there are people in the building that inspire me to sing without their even knowing that they're inspiring me to sing. There's many great artists on the market that I also get inspiration from. Stevie Wonder is one of them. Donny Hathaway, not too many people, well, a lot of people have heard of Donny Hathaway. He passed some years ago, but he was a great inspiration in my life. I grew up on Aretha Franklin. I grew up on Barbara Streisand, Nancy Wilson. I really, literally, I would come home from school and put on those albums and wear them out. You know, every little nuance that they would utter, you know, I had that down pat too. But all in all, there's been a lot of inspirations in my life, and it doesn't really take a lot to inspire somebody that really loves to sing. Baby, not if you really care for me, why don't you stay little Valentine, please stay. And each day will be Valentine's. I said each day will be Valentine's. Valentine's Day.
I started singing in a nightclub called the Cabin Inn, which was a place where there were nothing but gay people. And they would put me on the piano in my waitress uniform to sing. And I made a lot of money and tips and things like that, and I used to be singing Poor Butterfly and Solitude and such songs as that. And then I went, I worked there for quite some time, much to the chagrin of my parents when they found out that I was working in a club frequented by nothing but homosexuals. They were most unhappy. However, I stayed there quite some time and enjoyed it. I was working in and out of Chicago, but I went to New York in about 1938. And at that time, I worked in the various nightclubs and at the Chicago, at the Apollo Theater, and on 52nd Street, a place called Yacht Club. I have here a picture of myself and Billie Holiday. I'm working at another club called Tondelea's, and it's a picture of I prize highly because it's a picture of myself and a bass player by the name of John Simmons, and Billie is there with her dog Mister, and myself and a drummer by the name of Big Sid Catlett. And that's one of my favorite pictures because I love that picture because, particularly since I'm a dog lover, this picture is with Billie and with her dog, Mister, and I prize that picture highly. Fortunately, I got an opportunity to work with Count Basie, and this was before, right at 1945, for 44 and 45. And I remember I was working with Count Basie when and working in a theater in Wichita, Kansas, on the day that Roosevelt died. And I can remember I was singing a song called He's Home for a Little While. And they announced just before I went on, they announced that President Roosevelt had died. And I remember that very much because that's one of the things about Basie's band that I remember. After my sojourn with Count Basie, I went on went to USO, where I stayed for about a year and traveled in the China Burman India Theater. And that, of course, was one of the most the most interesting experience of my days in show business, because it provided a variety of scenes, and I enjoyed that very much.
Well, I would like to say that we probably in this room have another John Coltrane and Billie Holiday or whatever, just waiting to come
itself.
Out. The cycle continues, and especially
right.
in an age where every time you look on the news, you see dope is prevalent. I mean,
yeah, no,
we have
an advertisement.
It's an advertisement,
that's an
but
advertisement.
It's real. But
they
we
ain't
need
trying
to
say no to dope. They putting it in the neighborhoods.
Well,
they making
agreed.
It more available for you. Those advertisements.
But we need more monuments towards achievement, more institutions and examples. There should be a big sign out here right now. Out of this building came a lion. Out of this building is presently a lion. Mm-hmm. Something mm-hmm. that little kids walking down the street can say, like Fenner was saying, one day he wanted to be like them. He
mm-hmm.
is now.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I want to emphasize on what Paul was saying before, because when I come from another culture altogether,
okay.
and when I moved in the building, I felt a lot of respect. I felt like I was moving into a mecca of musicians,
mm-hmm.
and I felt even shy about practicing.
Yeah.
It's very personal, but I felt very shy because I felt, my God, all those great cats I've been living here, and I have learned later on that Anthony Braxton used to live where
right,
I live.
Right.
And I said, oh my God, all those cats practicing, and they're gonna hear me go practicing in this place. And I was real shy about it, and actually being in this building has made me very much stronger. And I wanna say the same thing happened to me as for Paul. It is that a lot of people, a lot of musicians did the same thing. They would make me play and then say, well, you see here, you did something wrong. Go do this, and the week after they play the same tune and say, well, you got that, but this you still ain't got it, so you better go work at it.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like it is very precious, because it would never, it only happens like this in on stage and within a certain community too. It is that if I'd come from the moon, they would have said, well, you can't play, just go home and bye.
Yeah.
And I feel like it has been, for me, and I hope it keeps on being, but it has been the most, it has been most precious.
Yeah.
One, two, thank you.
Thank you.